You're wearing the shoes. I was asking you which version you're wearing, merino wool or
tree.
What do you call
tree runners?
Tree runners.
Out of eucalyptus
they're
fiber.
a little bit lighter.
Yeah.
For the summer.
Yeah,
we're still in the summer?
Yes, we're there.
We're in October now.
They're great fall shoes.
Tell us about this. You just raised a bunch of new money. What are you going to do with the money?
Two big things. So, you know, we've had a really successful start to the company. We founded in March of 2016 and I think just met a great market need and created this comfortable product that a lot of people gravitated to. Sold a million pairs of shoes in the first 2 years. And so we're now at this juncture where we see a huge opportunity in front of us. And the investment areas we need to make are in places like new materials development.
Right.
Which is pretty costly to make brand new fibers and brand new polymers for the bottom units of shoes and put those into a fantastic product. So we're investing a lot in R&D, and we're also taking our show on the road and going to a bunch of international.
So you just
locations.
Raised $50 million. Now total, you've raised $75 million?
Yeah.
In total. But just, can we just go back to the origin story for a second, which is what made you think that you could come up with a shoe in what is a remarkably crowded business of a million, everybody makes sneakers, that somehow your sneaker was going to magically be somehow different and that it was going to catch on in this way that it has?
So to the honest answer is that my wife talked to my co-founder Tim's wife, and Tim had a wonderful idea. He was struggling a little bit. She said, call Joey. And I talked to him, and we said, you have an amazing idea. He had a wool shoe prototype. I thought people were gonna love it, and it
but why
like,
did you think that? When
well,
you when, it, didn't you say to yourself, "Well, Nike could do this.
No, there's really
Adidas
two things.
Could do this. Everybody could
there's,
do that." Why?
There's really two things. I think one is that everyone is kind of doing the same thing and fighting over here, so it's super competitive. But people are putting logos on shoes. They're making it flashy, and they're not recognizing that people are using shoes differently today. People are using them throughout their day in a much longer period. They're working on their mobile phones. So as apparel has casualized, and Lululemon's a great example of a company that's driven this just casual trend across someone's day, mostly with women in their case. And we saw that shoes hadn't kept up with that. So there was this big market need for a shoe that carried you throughout your day and hence needed to be comfortable.
I mean, a great idea. Obviously, it's taken off. What's your competitive moat, though? What keeps others from copying you now that you're big?
And tons of people are copying us. We knew that would happen. We didn't expect it to happen so fast. We have dozens of copycats already. And now some of the big companies are doing what I would call inspired by us. Products,
right.
which is frankly fantastic. It says we're doing something really well, and they've recognized a market need that we hit in this category we created. So the only thing that we can do, and we've been doing it from the beginning, is just keep innovating and try to cannibalize our own sales and not be worried about the fact that we might launch something and lose a little bit from one of our flagships.
You and so many direct-to-consumer new entrants have received what I might describe as tech valuations. I mean, valuations that historically would not be ascribed to a fashion retailer. And I'm thinking of the Warby Parkers of the world as well. You're going to try to get into the retail business, meaning bricks and mortar.
Yeah.
What makes the valuations that have been ascribed to these companies make sense, given that, to a large degree, they look like what might be classic companies?
Yeah, you know, I think it's one fundamental dynamic. So if you look at the shoe industry, 100% of the industry is driven by a wholesale model. And so every manufacturer and brand behind shoes, they make a certain cost, then they give a huge chunk to the retailer, then there's that price that the consumer pays. So if we skip that part, we can take that extra room in the cost structure and invest it into a much higher quality product sold at a much lower price. And that gives us this amazing opportunity to stuff tons of value in our product. So our product is made, the first one with merino wool is made with material typically used in $5,000 suits. And we've packed it into a $95 shoe that you can get at Allbirds.com, by the way.
Long term, is this a independent company, or do you think you roll up into a larger fashion conglomerate?
Well, we've always been from day one building this as an independent company.
Okay.
Everything we need to do to be a shoe company, from product development and manufacturing, we've put it all together, and that's our ambition.
It's a great story. Congratulations.
Thank you very much.